Alright, so in this video, we're gonna talk specifically about the lumbar plexus. Okay, so the lumbar plexus is really important, and we'll add some clinical correlation to it as well. So first, we're going to go through the topography, just talk a little bit about which nerves feed into the lumbar plexus. Then after that, we're going to make a scheme of the lumbar plexus. And to make this as easy as possible to understand and remember, we're going to draw the general outline first. Then we're gonna go ahead and go through each nerve and a little bit of clinical importance related to those nerves. And at the end, there'll be a little quiz. So let's go ahead and get started with the topography. So here we see the spinal cord within the vertebral canal. And here we see the spinal nerves leaving the intervertebral foramen. So there'll be one spinal nerve leaving on each side. They're paired. To be specific though, we're not really talking about the whole spinal nerve, right? We're actually talking about the anterior branch of the spinal nerve, because the anterior branch is what forms all the plexuses that we're going to talk about in this series of videos. So, lumbar plexus, formed by the spinal nerves. Which branch of the spinal nerves? The anterior branch. More specifically, the lumbar plexus is formed from the anterior branches of the spinal nerves L1, L2, L3, L4, and also a contributing branch from T12. So the lumbar plexus is located within the psoas major, lateral to the lumbar vertebrae. Let's now go ahead and simplify this drawing so that we can actually make a scheme out of this. Now, what I want you to do is to grab a piece of a paper and a pen, and I want you to draw the scheme with me. Once you do that, I promise you will remember this much, much easier. Alright, first off, L1 is going to give off a branch called the ilioinguinal nerve. So the primary nerve that the L1 gives off is the ilioinguinal nerve. The nerve above T12 is the subcostal nerve, right? It's not actually a part of the lumbar plexus, but the subcostal nerve is, it's a mixed nerve. It has a sensory and a motor function. Sensory for the skin on the lower abdomen and the inguinal region, and motor for the abdominal wall muscles. Now, the subcostal nerve, again, it's not a part of the lumbar plexus, but the reason why I mention it here is because it's going to give off a branch that's going to go with a branch of L1 to form the iliohypogastric nerve. And we will mention all of those in detail in a minute, but let's actually finish off the scheme first. Now, L2 will traverse this way. L1 and L2 will both give off a branch that go together to form the so-called genitofemoral nerve. L3 will traverse this way and join L2 in forming the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. L4 will traverse this way, right? Now, L3, L2, and L4 will go together in forming the femoral nerve. Then the last one, L4, will join L3 and L2 to form the obturator nerve. So that is our scheme. This is the basic outline of our lumbar plexus. Let's now go ahead and focus on each one of those nerves, starting at the top. The iliohypogastric nerve. Let's do the course first. This one is going to traverse laterally from the psoas major, then it's going to run above the iliac crest, traveling and terminates in the hypogastric and inguinal regions. Let's divide this one into cutaneous branches and motor branches. For the cutaneous branches, it's going to supply two places. We got the lateral cutaneous branch, which provides somatosensory innervation of the skin on the lateral abdomen, and the anterior cutaneous branch, which innervates the skin around the superficial inguinal ring. The muscular branches provide motor innervation for the internal oblique, and it's going to supply the transversus abdominis muscle. And as you know now from the physiology of those muscles, the transverse abdominis muscle is going to contract to increase the intra-abdominal pressure, to push on the diaphragm to assist with the forced expiratory process. Whereas the internal oblique is going to be one of those muscles that's going to primarily help with flexion of the abdomen, as well as increasing the intra-abdominal pressure for the forced expiratory process. Awesome. Now, Next, the ilioinguinal nerve is actually going to traverse laterally from the psoas major and continue below the iliohypogastric nerve, right? It follows the iliohypogastric nerve at the beginning. Then it travels through the inguinal canal to innervate the skin on the anterior part of the scrotum in men and the skin on the anterior part of the labia majora in women. So it's primarily a cutaneous branch. Okay, so we did the ilioinguinal and the iliohypogastric. Now, the genitofemoral nerve. Now, the genitofemoral nerve is actually going to, instead of going on the lateral side of the psoas major, like the iliohypogastric and the ilioinguinal nerve, this one is actually going to penetrate the psoas major and then leave it on the ventral surface to then give off a genital branch and a femoral branch. So genitofemoral branch, just split the word, all right? So the genital branch passes through the inguinal canal to innervate the cremaster muscle, as well as sensory innervation for the scrotum and a small area on the medial side of the thigh in men, while in women, it innervates a part of the labia majora and a small area on the medial side of the thigh as well. The femoral branch, however, passes through the vascular space to innervate the skin on the medial side of the thigh. Awesome! Next, lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh. This simple nerve will travel laterally from the psoas major, then run towards the anterior superior iliac spine, travel through the muscular space to reach the lateral thigh. It's called the lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh, so it will provide somatosensory innervation for the lateral thigh. Alright, now, femoral nerve, one of the really important nerves. The femoral nerve will travel laterally from the psoas major, travel above the iliopsoas, then pass medially through the muscular space to reach the anterior thigh. Once it reaches the anterior thigh, it will end up in the femoral triangle, then split into muscular and cutaneous branches. Let's do the cutaneous supply first. So one of the cutaneous supply branches is actually called the anterior femoral cutaneous branch. And you know, you can obviously tell where this one's going to supply. It's going to supply the anterior and a little bit of the lateral sensation of the thigh. The other branch is called the saphenous branch. And the saphenous branch is a really cool nerve because it's a terminal branch, or a terminal somatosensory branch. And what it does is that it follows the great saphenous vein. So it runs within the adductor canal. And on its way, it gives off the infrapatellar branch, which provides somatosensory innervation of the skin inferior to the patella. And it gives off the medial cutaneous nerve of the leg, which provides somatosensory innervation for the skin on the medial side of the leg. So what it really does is that it covers a good portion of the medial side of our thigh and leg, supplies the medial hip joint, medial thigh, medial knee joint, medial calf, and medial heel as well. So a lot of different cutaneous sensations come from this branch of the femoral nerve. So you can just imagine if there's any type of damage to the femoral nerve, the type of paresthesia that you would experience from this guy. Now, motor supply. The femoral nerve innervates a whole lot of muscles. That's why if there's any herniated discs or some type of situation where there's a compression of the femoral nerve, it can affect the ability to walk. Because the motor supply is iliopsoas for flexion of the hip. It also supplies the pectineus, which is also another muscle for flexion at the hip joints. It supplies the quadriceps femoris. And for those of you who know that it consists of the vastus medialis, lateralis, and intermediate, which they all cause extension of the knee. And it also consists of the rectus femoris, which causes flexion of the hip and extension of the knee. And another muscle that's going to be supplied by the muscular branches of the femoral nerve is the sartorius muscle. Sartorius can flex the hip, it can flex the knee, and it can even do a lateral rotation of the hip. So you can see if there's any damage or irritation to the femoral nerve. Let's go through some common causes here. Pelvic fractures can cause damage to the femoral nerve. Hip dislocation can cause damage to the femoral nerve. herniated discs at around L2, L3, and L4. That's why it's important to actually know what parts supply the actual nerve. Let's actually go through what a herniated disc is quickly so that you actually get a visual idea of this damage, because it's sadly very common. So here you have two vertebral bodies, and then you have a jelly-like material between those two vertebral bodies called nucleus pulposus, right? So nucleus pulposus is a jelly-like structure, and around it, there's going to be a lot of fibers called annulus fibrosus, consisting of cartilage, fibroid cartilage. So the spinal nerve is going to leave through the intervertebral foramen, right? Let's say for any type of situation, there's a compression or rotation or any situation that causes the nucleus pulposus to bulge out. And if it is herniated out from the annulus fibrosus, the connective tissue, it can obviously cause compression of those nerves. And if it causes compression of those nerves, it can affect the motor supply, causing peripheral paresis of those muscles, here supplied by the femoral nerve. Mainly, the reason for the impairment of walking function is due to weakness of the quadriceps muscle. If that happens, walking without support and walking upstairs can become difficult. It's almost impossible for patients to raise their lower limb when lying supine. And also standing and squatting can become unstable. Other symptoms that may occur is that it may also cause loss or paresthesia. So they might have pain, numbness, tingling within the medial hip, thigh, knee, leg, anterior and the lateral thigh. And a lot of different things can come if there's a damage to the femoral nerve. All right. So that's that one. Last one, obturator nerve. This nerve, again, comes from L2, L3, and L4. Then it travels medially from the psoas major and passes through the obturator canal. When it passes through the obturator canal, it branches into an anterior branch, which innervates the gracilis, which helps with hip adduction, knee flexion, and internal rotation. It supplies the adductor longus and brevis for hip adduction, supplies the pectineus, which flexes and adducts the thigh, and the anterior branch also provides somatosensory innervation for the medial thigh. This nerve will also branch out to a posterior branch for the adductor magnus for the adduction and medial rotation at the hip joint. Now, the obturator nerve also has muscular branches for the obturator externus. Alright, so that is mainly the big nerves that come from the femoral plexus. Now what I'm going to do is give you all a fairly easy quiz. I'm going to change all the labels to numbers and put the names in a table. Then I'm going to make all the names disappear. And can you, from the beginning, tell me what is the name of number 1? What is the name of number 2? What does number 3 supply and what does number 4 supply? If you can do that, then you've got a good grasp of this topic. There we have it, my friends. Thank you so much for watching another one of my videos. If you enjoyed, learned something from it, please remember to like, comment your favorite moment, subscribe, turn on those notifications. If you're looking for other ways to support, go ahead and check the link in the description box. See you next time. Peace.